Good afternoon, everybody, and of yes, like the music was saying, go, 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 we finally started the game, and yeah, we have here the lowest bracket match here between CDEC versus LGD. This is the Manila Masters Qualifiers, and my name is Hades, I'll be your caster for this series, and the next as well. So on this channel, we have your CDEC versus LGD, a best of three, followed up by Wings Gaming versus VGJ. Alright, so CDEC versus LGD, throughout the qualifiers, at least for the, you know, for the Kiev major, they were kinda, CDEC did pretty okay. These guys were quite solid. They, of course, they were one of the first three teams to qualify to at least the playoff brackets before that really, really weird tiebreaker. We had like basically three teams tied for first and another three teams tied for like fourth. Remaining. It was quite awkward. But anyways, LGD on their side, well, Yao hasn't really performed. Which is quite sad, to be honest. Like, you know, he's such a experienced player himself. Maybe this team just hasn't suited his playstyle, and maybe hasn't exactly hit that level of play which you would expect from him. Alright, just hold on. I'm trying to get the in-game volume fixed.
Dire team pick.
Yeah, test. I'm not so sure about the Dota in-game Dota TV sound, whether it's working, because I don't see that usual white bubble which pops up here. It could be a bug and is actually working. But yeah, I mean, back to the draft. I mean, you see CDEC pick up the Rubick and they ban out the Centaur. Okay, this is something strange because usually when you see the Rubick pickup, you would tend to expect the Centaur pickup. Because when you combine the Null Field with, you know, the Aghanim's damage reduction, is actually really, really strong. Not to mention you have a Centaur Pipe. You pretty much negate a ton of magic damage. It almost becomes non-existent. And even to a certain extent where physical damage comes in, of course, 50%, even with the nerf to it, Centaur is still such a viable hero. Right, but CDEC followed up with Ursa the Batrider. Like, you know, we said it before a couple of times if you guys have watched my previous cast, where Ursa is kind of like a replacement for Luna because his physical damage is still very reliable. There hasn't been much changes to him in the patch. I don't believe there has been any with the recent patch update. And with Batrider, it's just always good. It's good here to get some pick, like a good pick off with the last soul. LGD going for the Magnus Riki. Okay, this is something which I feel is a bit underrated in the with the Riki Cloak and Dagger, because Magnus with the Empower on the Riki does actually quite a fair bit of damage to a certain extent. Like, that's, you know, okay, do you remember, if you guys remember when Riki, at least the new Riki, first came out, I'm sure like you guys saw the videos where people were just playing Riki carry, like just farming a battle for you, getting crit, and you just cast a Cloak and Dagger there, but they realized that it took too long, and at the same time, you know, people can just walk out of it. Yeah, but I mean, Riki Eggs, you know, it's quite unfortunate we haven't seen that in competitive play. It's something which hopefully, for me personally, I'm hoping will actually come in one day. It sounds a bit cheesy, but think about it. I mean, it might bring Void back into the picture as well. You never know. But I mean, regarding this patch, the way 7.0 anything has actually worked for any of us in Dota, if there's one thing for certain is that the pace of the game is much quicker than before. I think the average game time is reduced significantly. And because of shrines and everything, you know, it just allows team play to be more efficient, sustained, and fighting. It just means like you have to watch the terrain on which you're fighting on. You have to pick your fights in the right places. But okay, LGD go back for a very squishy support in the Crystal Maiden, but you have to love that arcane aura. It's gonna help Riki with that roaming around problems. Like, if you guys play that roaming Riki, you're gonna know that sometimes you, or rather most of the times, you tend to have that mana issues. You're not really able to cast both the smoke and the blink, which is why, you know, this is like, I'm not sure it's a player preference thing, to be honest, but I think like it kind of varies. Sometimes if they want to test a tiny bit of extra damage, they will go into the blink strike. Otherwise, they're just looking for the huge slow and the great silence on tricky to catch heroes like, you know, a Quap, a Puck, these very elusive heroes. That's where you max the smoke screen. So it kind of, yeah, it kind of varies, if you know what I mean. But CDEC going back for the Lich. So the Lich should be that pause 5 pick, which we are, you know, hoping, or rather I would say it would be that really, really annoying ward hero for that matter. Alright, so at the same time, alright, LGD, what else can they go for? I mean, you pick up the Riki, you pretty much expect the Riki to be the pause 4, Crystal Maiden gets the pause 5. The good thing about the Crystal Maiden as well, you know, you pretty much let this hero just, she can actually catch up in the jungle quite decently. you're thinking that such a squishy hero isn't such a bad thing, but I like how, because the Chinese teams and maybe like Faceless, for example, they started incorporating Crystal Maiden as a core into the core support. When I say core, I mean a very important hero as part of the draft for most teams now. They probably realized that the aura is actually really good, especially since, you know, Arcane Aura did get buffed like a couple of patches back. I believe they increased it. Like, yeah. I mean, it's only mostly for the Crystal Maiden's own self-purpose, but it means that she's able to sustain a lot. Because otherwise, back then, you just threw a spell and you're like, oh shit, what am I going to do? But at least now, there's such a high probability that you can actually just run back in after a couple of seconds. And anyways, LGD go for that. Oh, that Cancer is here. The Slark. This is like the nightmare. So you can understand why Yao would ban Axe. Axe is pretty much a Slark's nightmare, or any melee hero for that, you know, for that question. And taking out the Ember, Jug. Ember, despite the nerf to the, I believe, his level 10 talent and the Veil of Discord, still quite viable, still dishes out a ton of damage. Really, really strong. And back to the draft, I mean, I'm actually kind of worried for CDEC, because Slark can easily purge off the Batrider. You need something right now who has a bit of crowd control. Rubick has only that one lift. But I guess it's not so bad. Lich with the Frost Armor can kind of help out a bit on the Ursa, making him quite hard. So if the Slark hits on him, it's going to be counter-efficient, usually. But if you're looking for the final picks now to take out the Storm, yep, LGD does need a mid hero. So judging from that, you know, maybe you get a couple of scrims in, like, or maybe even playing DPL, you kind of get a feel what you really want to ban out. But yeah, LGD taking out the OD. They might even consider letting the Magnus go mid, where they play something else in the offlane, say like... Venno. No, I was kind of thinking Clockwork for some reason, or... What else? Yeah, but okay, Venno's alright, I guess. Man, this is going to be really weird, but I actually really like the Venno pick, especially against Ursa. Like, you know, Ursa is an easy to kite around hero if he doesn't really get the swipes in after he blinks in. So Venno can really take care of that. A really well-placed or conveniently placed Venno ward can just mess around with you. And not to mention, if you don't get the quick kills immediately on the core heroes, Slark and Venno are just really good for these prolonged fights to a certain extent. It's just really good to a huge degree. When you have the Poison Nova go out, you know, your Rubick, your Lich can't really do much. But I would say Rubick has a ton of really good spells to steal this game. So I might even just keep my eye on the Rubick most of the time. Because you look at the Ricky, the smoke screen's going to be really big. Using it against LGD, using it in a really well-placed smokescreen could mess up with an RP. What else? Alright, so... Okay, I know the big thing for most of you guys, especially for me, I'm not sure about you guys, but I was really excited to see Monkey King added into Captain's Mode. Like, I believe players were talking about it for a while. If you notice, like, ISSI was spamming it in Southeast Asia servers. You see, Zai was spamming it as well. He went on like a 5-game Monkey King thing or something. I was watching his stream that day, and you could see the appeal behind it as well, playing in the offlane support role. But we'll talk about it later if it does come up. Otherwise, CDEC, they do pick up the Invoker pick, pretty standard. It pretty much secures that they have some late game. And because the Ursa is basically the mid game tempo controlling hero, or really should be played that way, could just mess around the Slark. Like, they have the potential to take the towers really quickly. You know, Batrider to lasso someone for the Ursa to chew the hell out of it. It's like, brrr, it did. And then Invoker just comes in, finish up the Sunstrikes with this. You know, there's a lot of synergy out there. Lift into Sunstrike, lasso into Sunstrike, all these spells. And Chain Frost can be so annoying sometimes. Chat, please. Alright, so, something's up. Hold on, just let me quickly check what's wrong with this. Alright, so, I guess I kind of have some volume back at least. I think the in-game volume, yeah, it's back now. Did it actually change it? Because I don't think this popped up when I was in the draft. Yeah, so introducing the teams now. You have Yao from LGD playing the Radiant side and the Crystal Maiden. Ame playing on the Slark. M99 playing on the Ricky. Maybe we'll be playing on the mid Venomancer. Offlane will be played by Eggsy. On the Magnus. Oh, wait. Okay, so on the Dire side, Flyby is going to be playing for CDC on the Ursa, Rubick is going to be played by Demons, you have Inflame playing on the Invoker, June on the Lich, last but not least, Sep playing on the Batrider. Alright, so you can see right here that June, because he's in the, you know, he probably will hang around in the mid for a while, afterwards just help Sep control this creep wave, because you keep eating the range creeps. The good thing about the rework to the experience thing, it kind of messes around the supports. If you can't control the creep wave well, you're pretty much just screwed. And the good thing about whether he hangs mid or the bottom lane, you pretty much ensure that you can stack these camps, or stack even these camps, and next thing you know, your Batrider is just gonna have a ball of a time. All he needs to do is just, you literally just get levels, and you're actually winning the lane for your team. Alright, but anyways, here we go guys, this is only game 1 between CDC versus LGD. Let's go into it. XZ against Magnus, this should be an okay-ish matchup for him, because he can still spam out the shockwaves, doesn't have to worry so much, but M99 already being a pain for Inflame. He's gonna depend a lot on the side lanes to really get these kills, or making sure that he actually gets closer to the Midas, so he doesn't have such a bad time. That's the good thing about the Invoker. If you see Invoker having a bad time, you don't have to worry so much about, you know, babysitting it. You just want to make sure the side lanes, at least you can set up some kills for his Sunstrikes. But that's also presuming he can actually hit the Sunstrikes. You know, otherwise I'm pretty sure some of you guys had traumatized by a really bad pop where for some reason none of his Sunstrikes even land. You could put a whale there, he misses that too. But oh, maybe under tower will be a huge creep wave. I think they're gonna go here right into Inflame. And if M99 are gonna start rack-hacking him down, that will be the first blood, I believe. Going the way to the Ricky. Very nicely done already. And then you can see the power. June. Did he stack anything? No, but he went somewhere. Yeah, this is going to be a really tough time. Maybe he's basically the super slow. One thing about the Venomous Gale and his passive in the Poison Sting, it's going to make walking out of that smoke screen even slower. Like, you can imagine the response time. You're basically crawling out. It's like someone's dragging you on the floor. I'm not sure if you guys know as well, like the level 25 Talon, that 3 times Plague Ward HP and damage is broken. If the Venom ever gets to that stage, it's actually really, really scared. And if you don't have much experience playing against it, it will definitely cause a lot of problems. But okay, Lich already helping to pull the wave to the side. Army not having the best of times, as Batrider has the level 3. So even if a stick, he's gonna have a really rough lane here, and that's why you can see that, you know, Crystal Man has decided to just kind of leave him alone. At least with the solo EXP, he gets closer to level 6, you know, and then he can start to kind of jungle a bit between the two camps, or even the medium camps, not so bad. Oh, but maybe he's getting quite a bit of luck, now he's getting a haste rune as well. This is just like, super annoying, really. Not even getting a point in the poison wards. But yeah, Lich is going to consider stacking. They are pinging it out. They say Lich is off the map, but maybe going to chase after Inflame. He's going to be running there. Oh, does see him. They need to slow. They're just diving him under the tower. He doesn't even have a smoke screen. So he's not afraid about the ghost walk, apparently. Probably realizes that he doesn't have the quads anyways, so no ghost walk. This is a trend though. Like, you see more Rikis, just play the Alacrity build. And the CDC supports aren't really in any situation, any position to try and help out the Invoker. But then, oh, is he actually thinking about going from behind with the Lich? Yeah, they're just gonna walk. They're just gonna walk from behind the Tier 1. What? They're thinking about it. Okay, I mean, you can wait for 40 seconds, but that's a really long time. Invoker just wants his, like, shrine up. Unfortunate. Almost has his Ring of Aquila. You probably want to wait for nighttime as well, unless maybe he's out of position. Ricky's just being such a pain in the ass with this going on him right now. Yep, they will start walking up. Sep does get to kill bottom lane. Now go for the Sunstrike. Oh, misses it. Jukes with the Blink Strike. But the Frost will kill him off. So Inflaming, maybe they're just going to right click onto this Venomancer. Do they have enough damage? They're crying for the body blocks right now. Demons right clicking him away. Tossing him to the green snowballs and poof. Nicely done. And it's going to be a 2-4 in trade. But you do lose the Invoker. So that's quite a fair bit gone. The supports, well, secretly happy. You know, sometimes when you rotate to the mid, your core dies. He's not happy, but the supports are just like, eh. You know, nothing of value was lost. He deserved to die, I guess, kind of. But, yeah. Alright, so 3-2, and Army dying bottom lane to Sep. Pretty much accelerates his timing towards the Blink Dagger. He's going to have Tranquils coming up soon. Ball of a time for him, actually. 14-1, top lane, pretty much free form here for the Ursa. And going for the going for the face. It should be the Helm of Dominator build. It's great stats as well. It means you're not too reliant on that Vladimir's offering. Demons just waiting for maybe to try and dive. Now going back for the lift into the Sun Strike. Bang! Does land just at the very tip and they kill him off with Fade Ball. So, alright, CDC in fame getting just a bit more respite as he actually gets a break for the first time in the game. I mean, probably the best case scenario obviously would be to get the kill. Slark, gonna try and snap a Bounty Rune, I believe, but he does bump into June instead. So, yeah, when you see the supports there, you know the Bounty Rune isn't there anymore. Magnus, well, he's 13 and no, he's not that, you know, it's not that shabby, but if you compare it to the Bat Rider, obviously Bat has the better time, seeing as it was a dual lane situation. Dual off lanes are actually a thing now. Like, I do believe, you know, back in previous patches, tri lanes are pretty much what you would consider the more high skilled techniques, but because of the way the EXP works, hold on, middle lane, going for the blink, and into the smokescreen, he needs to get out, but actually he will die here to the Venomancer, so maybe getting himself another kill, and with the Frostbite from the back, June not really able to chase up. And back to my point, like the way the EXP mechanics work right now, you know, we just adapt. No in-game sound. Serious? No. Okay, I fixed that just now, so you guys should be okay after this. Anyways, Ame. Still not yet level 6, but Sep is. So, oh, he could actually just run this one down. That's really scary, but Inflame getting the kill into Yao. And yeah, this could actually be a kill, but he doesn't have the Flame Break, so no way to push the Slark back, and he's just gonna back this one off. Maybe kind of rotating in, doesn't have the Firefly anymore, and immediately TP out from Sep. Oh, trying for the skewer back. Onto the Ursa, not the smartest decision there, trying for the smoke screen for the miss rate, but unfortunately he's outside, and Flybait gonna find himself a free kill. I think Magnus just tried to push him off so that he'd be still on the cliff, but it's very unfortunate. And maybe TPing to the top, it was very forced as well. It's not too late for him to go back into a Midas. It's still pretty early into the game. 6-3, and CDEC just having this, you know, the slightly better laning phase at least. Ho ho ho, just taking care of the sentry's mid. He's not gonna get a blink anytime soon. Yeah, just playing around with him. But he does get the tango up, so that's gonna be a wasted 100 gold. And Demon's going for the lift, but unfortunately, don't think he'll get the return kill onto M99. Going for the Sunstrike. Bang! Oh, in flame! On fire. Alright. Alright, you don't mess with that Invoker Lord. This guy. Out of nowhere. Should be getting himself pretty decently to a Midas, I believe. But okay, maybe, you know, having to buy his own tangos. It has been a very active lane, very crowded lane, in fact. Now over here in the bottom lane, this ward did scout them out. They put the sentry down as well. They know that M99 is there. Could be thinking about going for a telekinesis. They might go for Yao instead. Yep, they lift him back into the loving arms of Flyby. Very, very tasty killing. But Holo now used his first poison Nova. Smoke screen's gonna be there. It will send them back for a tiny bit. But now going for the screen to the RP. Very aggressive player from XZ. But do they have the follow-up? Demons actually will be the first casualty and they want to chase behind the tower. Can they kill Flyby here? They need to kill Flyby, but the TP's coming out already. So, June, all alone here, now go for the Sunstrike. Can they get the kill here? No, very, very close. And they will just content themselves with taking the easy Lich kill onto maybe. But here comes Sep. I think you TP'd into the wrong neighborhood. Smokescreen's gonna be there. They pop the dust. He wants to go for a quick kill, maybe for a last soul. But it seems like, oh, he's actually gonna use it now. And that should be the kill onto XZ, I believe? Oh, he gets the double! Oh, the fade from the napalm stacks actually got him the kill, so I would say that's still hashtag worth it for him. He died there, but it gets him that much closer. So maybe if the triple kill nonetheless, plenty of kills going to one specific person over there, that top skirmish. Pretty okay. Nice triple ancient stack. No, it's a double. But Slark, he's gonna be the happiest on this. He's going for the Midas. It's a comeback Midas. It's not that bad. It's pretty good.
Dire's top tower is under attack. Invisibility.
Alright, so 10 to 7. I would say we are quite lucky, guys, because Chinese Dota, you know, it's not all that resident sleepy. But hold on, in the middle lane, going for the leap. Just at the very tip of the smoke screen, he's gonna try. Oh, the ghost walk, he actually gets out! I thought it'd be a bit bigger than that, but okay. Oh, going for the lift. He needs to be able to do extra damage. He does get the kill in flame, but he does die anyways to maybe that poison tick. Probably shouldn't have come out Ghostwalk, but anyways, yeah, okay. It's not bad. You don't get the kill. Pretty worth it for him. Flyby. Like I said, it's going a bit ahead of Dom. Like, despite the tiny nerf, I was kind of curious to see whether the players were still. Well, the teams will still pick that up, but anyways, now he's just going straight up the TP out. They're not killing Flyby. Plenty of AXP here. And you have to love this area, because with Batrider, now that the Ancients actually take the magic damage, it helps with farming up a quick blink dagger. And you can see, he already has it, in fact. I've never seen a golem so black before. Yeah, I've actually never seen a golem this black before. Okay, so this is what happens when you have 10 napalm stacks on you. Alright. I mean, don't get me wrong, guys. Like, I know it gives you, like, a bit of black after a few stacks, but I mean, completely covered in black, that's the first time. And in flame, bit of a, you know, escaping a tough jiffy. Goes into Ghostwalk again. 500 gold to that Midas recipe, but not having the best of time. So Ursa getting his own Frost Armor Ogre. Alright, so he's gonna have to double Frost, but. Now top lane, I think they want to try for something with the debut of the Blink Dagger. And perfect efficiency here, they will do the Roshan as well while debuting this Blink Dagger. Okay, the ward didn't see them, so now he's going to try immediately into maybe. He needs to try and save him, maybe try for a skewer, try and screaming, but missing it. And now go with the RP, catching onto him just barely, but the Poison Nova is going to pop out anyways. And the Chain Frost did finish him off. But now with the Frostbite, that should be a kill onto Sepp. I think maybe gets a free kill here. Sunstrike, oh, just outside. Majoon doesn't really have the Frost. Flyby actually killing off M99. Very casual sentry being placed out. Nice game sense coming out from the Ricky, but Demon's even better. One step ahead, being the sentry there just in case. So 13-9. Alright. Man, this game is very, very active, guys. Very, very active. And he has the Midas recipe now. This is where he starts to scale even better. Poof, poof, poof. Alright, guys. You know. Games are good, games are good, we had a good time. Alright, so let's see, how is Venom building this game? Well, he's going to a Dragon Lance, so that's not bad actually, because when you think about the extra attack range, the stats, Dragon Lance is still always going to be good because it provides you so much decent stats for the cost. So the cost efficiency and especially for ranged heroes, the extra attack range. No matter what, I think it's still going to be a good item, like on heroes like, you know, SF, Sniper, it's always good. Longer is always better. Alright, so Ame, now that he has his Midas as well for a while, he's actually going to make his way into a Shadow Blade. Or I would like to believe it's a Shadow Blade. But with the Roshan, they will just smoke up, hit to the bottom lane, waiting for Flyby to get his own Blink Dagger. They know the Slark is there, they see him. Or they last saw him there. Waiting on the Slark, oh it pops, he's gonna go straight. Oh, he blinks straight onto the Ricky instead! Not the ideal target, but anyways, they will take the quick kill. Once you go, you just can't pull out. And Flyby, they will take themselves the what looks to be the first tier 1 of the game, as LGD will try to push at least the middle tier 1 for a trade. The TPs are coming back, so June and the red team could be thinking about trying to contest the tower. Yao and friends already going a bit further behind, trying to catch someone out of position. But without the Firefly and the Lasso, I don't think they're really trying to hold this. They will just try their best to hold. TP coming in. Maybe they actually try with the Flame Break. Level 3 Flame Break. So Slark just kind of hanging around. Did go ahead to complete the treads first. Flyby has priorities. He wants to pretty much go far. You're not catching the Slark that easily. He can just Shadow Dance out. Alright, so they're going to try to look for someone again. Lasso's coming off cooldown in 25 seconds. And every Lasso they can use and get a kill with, still pretty, you know, pretty big win. Let's see, how is Invoker's farm doing? Still making his way to his Aghanim Scepter. Slark's not getting any good farm for a while, that's for sure. If anything, it's up to his friends, like maybe to... Oh, is he actually still going for the Midas? Or is this going to be like a Maelstrom? I'm gonna say Maelstrom, but anyways, they use a scan. They know what's going on. Now I'm just gonna try and bait. If they can kill the Magnus very quickly, I think they were waiting for the cooldown. Into the Firefly, looking for the flank. The TP's coming in though. He gets the Frostbite to Ursa, but over the backline, going for the lasso onto the Venomancer, looking for the RP, catching them all the way into the smoke screen. And Yao with a very big ultimate. Two heroes already died, and now make it a third. Big kills for maybe. And alrighty, there's the big break he needs. Whoo hoo hoo! Into the smoke screen, followed by the Frost Nova, the freezing field, sorry, and bang, that's so much damage, really, really well played. And Eggsy, he's gonna get a blink dagger just from clearing this hard camp. Inflame was in there the whole time, he's just doing invoke things, you know? Pretty much the first 18 minutes, you pretty much just wanna make sure that you get your items up at least. Get the Midas and slowly scale up, or rather quickly scale up into your eggs while your team pretty much tries to create space for the Sunstrike kills. Alright, so Slug's opting to go for the Blink Dagger first. I think that's okay. Instead of the Shadow Blade, you're not so reliant. So, at least when you initiate, it's easier. You know, you see, you just go. Instead of the Shadow Blade. Sometimes it's a player preference thing as well. Like, I mean, I've even seen more Slugs starting to play like Phase Boots, Echo Saber, just because they want to get the extra bit of movement speed with the phase. But alright. Anyways, the tier 1 tower bottom did go down, and the map control, however, is still very evened out. Between the two teams, Flyby needs to do just a bit more, but he's going to be farming to the BKB. Roshan's not going to be up yet, but with the Firefly up again, they should be trying for a kill. Yeah, I think instead of going on Venom, they probably would have opted to go for the Magnus. That could have saved them a bit better. He was really close as well, if they had waited 4 more seconds. Double damage. Alright, and right, he has at least, he can afford these two components. He needs the point booster. Z with the blink. We'll see whether he can make those really big plays. I mean, the good thing about Dota sometimes, you know, when you watch, especially as a spectator, no matter what, as long as you land these huge teamfight spells, 5-man RP, 5-man anything, you're definitely gonna scream, no matter what. You're just like, oh! Oh, damn! Stuff like that. It's always that kind of stuff which gets you, doesn't it, guys? But yeah, CDEC, they will go for a smoke gank, wanting to find that lasso kill again. Four staff almost completed on Sep. M99, if he breaks the smoke. Oh no. But they're going to the top lane. They might find the Slug. I think they see him. Yep, they see him. They definitely saw him. Going right on into the lasso. Bang! It'll be a quick kill into the Slug, even committing the rage for that. Flyby is not happy. So Big Bear gets a Salmon kill. And they will try for the tier 1 tower, but no, the smoke flank play coming up from LGD, this could be pretty big. Yeah, all the way forward, and the Firefly is just about to expire. They found it, the Frostbite him up, they freeze him up nice and frozen. Now the Chain Frost bouncing around between Maybe and Yao, doing quite a fair bit of damage. We'll get the kill, looking for the Sunstrike, maybe he's almost down, we'll get toasted up. And now looking for the 2-man RP, XZ doesn't have any more follow-up, the telekinesis, and Flyby will be like, thank you. Oh, yummy, 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 but oh, he needs the damage, he does get it. So four heroes go down, Ricky at the sidelines unable to do anything, and Inflame just goes to the bottom to farm. So pretty big fight there for CDEC. LGD just outplay themselves. Pretty good game. And Invoker just continues to push out a bit. Aghanim Scepter completed, should beat the Boots of Travel, at least with a bit more mobility. Global Presence would definitely be there. And they can try for the mid tier 1, I think. Good thing about this creep is Speed Aura. Don't underestimate it, guys. When you have this hero around, you get a Spirit Breaker, Speed Aura, you just activate it, bang. Everyone's just like, woo-wee! Flash. Alright, so, drums on the Rubick first item. This, I never saw this coming, but at least it makes him a bit tankier. When you compare it to the other heroes, I guess. See, Ricky's at 820 HP, Crystal Maiden's at 860. Hey, that extra 100 HP could save your life, and now they're just attempting to slowly push down this tier 1. Slark already with the blink will be opting to go for Assange and Yasha. I was kind of hoping that he would go for Lincolns just because he needs the defensive item against that Batrider. But looks like he's just going to depend solely on timing and game sense. Alright. Inflame. Oh, he's actually going for the blink dagger first. Alright, that's still a pretty good item as well. It helps you set up stuff easily. And not to mention with your tornado, setting up your spells, those are the big things. And maybe he's also pretty big, but it looks like he's run out of steam as he has dipped a bit behind. Because Invoker's pretty much been free farming the side lanes, just split pushing and all that. So Maelstrom, Dragon Lance, BKB on the way. They'll be okay like against Invoker. But the big like problem for me, I feel, is this Ursa still. Because once he gets their BKB, who's gonna stop him? Maybe an RP, but you don't want to commit an RP just to stop him like that. And if anything, after the BKB, he can always go into an egg. So if he gets RP, he just presses R. Useless RP afterwards. Alright, so casual region rune being picked up, and it looks like both teams are just kind of hovering around the mid. As maybe actually, oh, Rubik stole the plague wards. Alright, so this is, let the battle of the wards begin. This is like StarCraft all over again. Forge Spirits coming in. If anything, they will probably just avoid the middle lane for a while. It's just more of the pains of pushing into a Venom. Like, after a while, it becomes a bit useless. But by level 25, those things become really super annoying. I think one time I tried it, I couldn't even move out of my own base. Oh, they go straight for the jump onto Inflame. They have the dust. Yes, we do. Inflame going for the tornado now, but the frostbite's coming out. Oh, looks like they actually might find two. They're going to try to drop the Meteor down and then lift up into the Magnus. That should be the kill. And they're going to look for a bit more follow-up now, trying to kill into M99. But the last one of the backline, they go straight for the Crystal Maiden, getting the pull back up into the middle of the team. And actually, M99 is going to blink away, trying to opt, but no, but the freezing field comes out. Is it going to be enough damage? No, I don't think so. With the Poison Nova, CDEC. And now Army comes back in to blink away, but unfortunately, maybe gets the double, and we find the third. Now he goes, oh, actually, he does find the third. All right. Big stuff. Full team weapon, LGD, winning themselves their first big team fight. 3-5. 2.6k, gold swing, big stuff, and now they will find themselves a tier 1 as well. So this Slark, yeah, I'm pretty sure this happens. Like, you know, sometimes when you're playing against a Slark, you're like, okay guys, off lane, you know, you wreck the lane, Slark died like 0-5. But just because in the mid game he gets these really easy kills with a Blink or a Shadow Blade, and next thing you know, he's just a nightmare of all our pubs. Going for the Sunstrike into Roche, won't find it there, no one's there. Yeah, this is gonna take a bit of getting used to. Like, the TPs, I wish they... I mean, I'm okay with the animation, the way it works, we see the heroes, but... Valve, Ice Frog, Lord Frog, please give me back my colors. Like, when you play years of Dota, or even months, you're just pretty much conditioned to react based on the colors. Like, you know who's coming in, and just from the colors alone, and you're like, oh, it's him, alright, we go. But once you see the images of the heroes, sometimes, like, if there's a visual bug, you're like... Revenge? Drow? I don't know, and then suddenly you're like, oh shit. But then again, you know, it just could be us being forced to learn and adapt. That's what Dota is all about. Who learns faster? Who does learn faster compared to other regions, actually? Could be a culture thing as well if you guys think about it. Alright, so 21-18, this game's starting to spice up. Nice Chinese spicy. Oh, trying to force staff away. He's getting frozen up, but no more follow-up. They don't want to overcommit into territory with no vision. I like the wards on LGD. But unfortunately, CDEC seem to be avoiding the area just nicely. Not going for the leap forward. Won't the pounce. Yeah, I don't think he's going to find Inflame. Inflame is just waiting. Going to use the double forge spritz and slowly push out this wave. But they will try for smoke. Before, even if they can find the pickoffs, they will go into Roshan. But now the unfortunate time. Oh, I see that. They see this Slark. Going back for him right now. The tornado up. He's going to try and purge it off. Should be popping the shadow downs. There we go. The EMP is going to miss. This could be just a huge mess up. Make caught between everybody. Doesn't have an ultimate anymore. And Flyby will just eat him up. And we're going to the backline. Now they want to go straight for maybe. But hold on. That ultimate and BKB is wearing off. Not sure what you're doing. Flyby. You can't do this by yourself, the freezing food! We'll toast this bear up. Looks like he did not eat enough for hibernation. So back to the base he will go. And losing the Rubik at the backline as well with that M99 Ricky. Yeah, you know when you try to overcommit? That's what happens. Your team gets punished and... Yeah, not the plan. That was like, what, 9 second BKB? Yeah, that was his... Oh, that's, well, that was his 10 second BKB. Alright, huge mess. Invoker of the Blink also will now be looking to build his way up into his, you know, his boots of travel. Alright, 24 minutes in. Let's see, maybe he's alone in the top lane. They could actually try for him. M99 gonna build his way into his defusal blade. Oh, he's actually almost in the recipe. And he's just going to be that huge pain in the ass as well. With that cloak and dagger. Poof. Empower. Magnus, buff me. Ping, 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 ping. Buff me. You buff me! Alright, so they go for the 4-man smoke. No wards there, no deep wards placed from the side of CDEC at all. And now maybe we're gonna see who the slug would try and pounce. Might decide, oh, going to the high ground, but immediate blink reactions from Sepp. And of course, they will just run this one off. Ursa will also be getting out of there. But Invoker trying to go for the outplay, and he just outplayed himself. And Ame getting the kill onto him. And they can actually do Roche without the Invoker in like 50 seconds, but they probably suspect that he might have buyback. Alright, screw it. Roche, here goes. Pretty sure they're pinging out as well. Like, flyby is there, so you keep M99 outside just in case with the smoke. He puts the ward down as well, right under near the ancient camp, and it actually gives him vision of flyby. Yep, they know. They know. Oh, Gem on Sepp. Looking for the flame break, pushes them back just a tiny bit. They want to slow this down as much as they can. 15 seconds on the Invoker. Can they slow it down just in time? They put the sentry down. Now, immediately taken out by the plague wards, and that will be the Roche going the way to the slot. It doesn't seem like CDC, you know, successfully stalled. They probably should have committed that time to try and get whatever resources off the map they could have milked. But this game is just back and forth, back and forth.
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
Right, in flame, going to the ghost walk mode. This is the rat invoker we usually know. I think they want to try. Ooh, Sepp, they found a tasty kill into maybe the big kill. And a dominating streak as well for Sepp. Bad Rider because of the awesome lane. I know it's good to see that at least he's making use of the farm. But hold on, hold on. Killing off in flame. I'm sorry for missing that, but looks like they want to go for demons. Can they get the kill here? No, people to Plague Ward slowing them back, but M99 is still very, very angry. Does he actually want to commit for this? I don't think so. So they will just back off. And yeah, like I said, this game constantly back and forth. The mid players are just constantly getting picked off. But that's because if you look at, like, you know, the Invoker and maybe, these guys play a very similar playstyle. They're very, very aggressive. But I think this was, I would say that this draft, it's kind of working out for them. LGD, they're playing really, really greedy when you go with the Venom pick and the Slark Midas. But after all, hey, he went for Diffusal Blade, okay. Diffusal's great against Ursa as well, and that's great for the Purge. Can't purge yourself there anymore, but that's sad. Alright, XZ, waiting on the high ground. They have the terrain advantage. If any sad swords go over, instantly RP kill. Right there. Good thing about them power as well, in general, is just the way you help your cores farm up a bit quicker. Bit of extra damage output. They're pinging the lines out, so you look at the minimap, they want to go up the high ground. Ame. Sepp, you want to be careful, he's just going to pounce all the way forward very, very aggressively. Yes, you have the Aegis, but now going for the lasso all the way to the back line. And now he's just going to pop the BKB with the Chain Force and the Poison Over being thrown up. And no one's dying. June will die to the Cloaks and Daggers. And Sepp also going down to that beautiful Ricky. But hold on, Baron in the back line going hammer to Yao, killing him off first. But Yao basically at this point, he's just there to die. But yeah, flyby. Everything thrown up, killing off maybe. It's going to be a 2-for-2 trade. And now they're going over to the back line, going straight into Inflame, into the smoke screen. M99 probably going to get himself a nice tasty kill here. But XZ is nope, mine. Takes the shockwave there. So it's going to be a 4-for-2 trade. Very nicely done from LGD. And it actually looks like, I would say for the first time this game, they can, you know, after winning 2 fights in a row, they have found themselves in a very, very advantageous position. Alright, so now I'm getting a bit of damage out, and they didn't even burn the Aegis. That was the big part. And if you notice that Ame, he actually used like 2 diffuse charges just to try and save the CM. I mean, yeah, it didn't work out, but because he kept diffusing the Ursa and slowing him down, no one to back him up, he just dies. I remember what I said during the draft, that when you're in Ursa, you need to make sure you tear someone up quickly and then go on to the next target with your team. It's basically trying to capitalize on the manpower advantage. So without that control with no disables around, you just die very, very easily. Right, so 26 to 25. And yep, just for info guys, with those of you just starting to tune in onto the stream in Dota TV, this game is just game one of the best of three with CDEC versus LGD. Oh, Ame, he's found Sep. Won't even get to the shrine. The gem's on the floor. That's a big item drop. Do you need to pick it up? Sunstrike? I mean, it doesn't really matter to Ame, but anyways, XZ is going to pick it up. And now look for the chain frog. It's going to bounce between Yao. Ricky, don't kill your teammate. Jude actually will go down to Yao. Or not. I take that back. M99 getting the kills. And once again, CDEC. You know, it started out really strong, but now it just feels like everything's just gone to shit. And Flyby pops the rage. Ame's just gonna walk this one off, regen some HP, and blinks up to the cliff, but they see him. They're like, nope, where are you running? Kite the angry bear, poke the angry bear, pokey, pokey, pokey. This should be the team wipe, no TP. Oh, get wrecked. Forever alone. So they lose only the Crystal Maiden. Alright, so you can see, like, you know that Ricky? Like I talked about, once he gets the Diffusal Blade, with the cloaks and dagger, tricks of the trade. What am I saying? I've been calling it the wrong skill the whole time. Oh shit. Yeah, okay, cloak and dagger is passive. But yeah, tricks of the trade. Poof, poof, poof. I'm sorry about that, guys. I'm a bit high. And alright, Ame going straight into Sep. Bang! And oh, he even wasted the last soul. That's really big. This should be one lane of barracks, if not two. Oh, this is some good Dota, I gotta admit, guys. I did not expect LGD to win because CDEC actually wrecked LGD in the Kiev major qualifiers. But anyways, Ame, he's on fire. 30 essence stacks, and with that extra, all that June is like, we're done. All right, this is just game one over. So hopefully CDEC can make something happen. We're coming back into game two, showing their dominance, which they actually had. Alright guys, that was game 1 of CDEC versus LGD. My name is Hades. If you enjoyed the cast, if you have any feedback, or if you cringed a bit too much, I hope you guys had a good time. And if anything, just give me a like on Facebook or Twitter and social media at Hades.tv. So I'll see you guys for the next game shortly. Take a quick break, don't go anywhere.